Shalom, fellow Rastafari. Concerning Habakkuk chapter 3 verse 7. Now, chapter 3 of the book of the prophet Habakkuk is actually a prayer, and if we would just 1 second to actually go to that. So excuse me. But okay, this was actually referenced by Schofield Reference Study Bible when referring to the book of the prophet Jonas, and then chapter 2 basically of the book of the prophet Jonas is pretty much a prayer as well. And so Reference Study Bible indicates that we should go on forward to Habakkuk chapter 3, and now chapter 3 of the book of the prophet Habakkuk verse 7, it reads, "I saw the tents of Cushan in affliction, and the curtains of the land of Midian did tremble. Now I saw Ra'a Re'e in the Ethiopic in the Bamarena, and I saw, not only I saw, but it was revealed, it was made able to see, it was made shown to the peoples," basically. The tents referring to the tabernacles. Only two individuals set up tabernacles, one being Moses, married to an Ethiopian woman, Zipporah, and we have Solomon, being, you know, having that relationship with, well, that marriage, in all reality, with Queen Makeda of Ethiopia, the Queen of the South, the Queen of Saba, of Sheba, and, you know, their son Menelik and all that. And so these two individuals that set up tents, the marriage with Ethiopian women, much significance. We won't go into that detail in this presentation, but we seek to do so on the forward. So now the two tabernacles, one in the wilderness set up by Moses, and one set up by Solomon, the house of the Lord, basically the house of David, from which descends, you know, that seed that is, that was, that eventually would be that Lich Teferi, born 1892, you know, 3 days. Well, I guess we have to, for sure, we would have to make mention of the sign of the prophet Jonas and the whole 3 days, three nights in the belly of the fish, of the whale. But I guess it'd be best if we just finish this up really quick before we even reference that. So I saw, or it was made known, it was shown, the house of David, the tabernacle of the Almighty, the house of David of Cushan, and Cushan being, you know, the Hebraic word for that would be Cush, Ethiopia. And even here it has a letter A referencing one of these little side notes or middle notes, and it reads, "or Ethiopia." So basically it was made shown, the house of David of Ethiopia, in affliction. Now affliction is extremely interesting in the sense that the word, the Hebraic word for affliction actually indicates vanity, vain, emptiness, fraud of words and lies, basically. And it gives the sense, the word gives the sense of negation, of negative, what's it called, excuse me, a negative aspect, negative form, a negation, denial. It basically breaks down to the word no. And so it's very interesting how this reminds us the affliction of Ethiopia in 1936 with the invasion of that alliance of Benito Mussolini, fascist Italy, allied with Victor Emmanuel and Vatican Rome, and that whole situation. And the affliction was that when His Imperial Majesty spoke before the League of Nations, you know, the answer was no. And His Majesty, the first power of the Trinity, he asked, "What answer am I to take to my people?" And the answer was nothing. No, they did not help Ethiopia. And so And so it's interesting how this song, verse 7 in the third chapter of the book of the prophet Habakkuk, goes into pretty clear and obvious detail as to how prophetic this was and how it came to pass before it came to pass, how it was spoken before it came to pass, so that when it would come to pass, we may believe, you know, for all Ras Teferi, thus establishing peace and tranquility, you know, that we can have faith in the Almighty, that His words do not pass away, and everything that has ever been, everything that is and will ever be, will be but the will of the Most High God, Jah Rastafari, and so we can trust in His word, and let us not be ashamed, and let us have faith in Him, you know, in and through Jesus Christus, Yeshua HaMashiach. And so we continue on by reading verse 7, and the curtains, kind of giving the idea of the rattling in a sense, but the whole making a noise, the whole movement, like the curtains flapping in the wind, we could say, but kind of like indicating a noise, a loud noise, and we even compare that to the fear within, deep in the hearts of the leaders of the world when they were confronted by His Imperial Majesty, how, you know, how everyone in Geneva, Switzerland, in the League of Nations, the leaders, like little children like the beast that they are, just started making all kinds of noise and whistling, kind of to, you know, out of fear, because confronted by the Most High, by Him that be who we be, His Imperial Majesty, the first power of the Trinity, Haile Selassie, Edamawi, we might say, Edamawi, Haile Selassie, you know, the conquering lion of the tribe of Judah, elect of God, King of Kings of Ethiopia, and the curtains of the land, even land is interesting, you know, it gives a sense of Eritrea, Eritrea, and so, like, and what is to crawl in its belly on the ground, on the land, on the earth, which is kind of like another pronunciation for Eritrea. Well, we know that serpents crawl on the ground, and it's interesting how like the Italians, you know, one of the first places that they reached was through the Red Sea, was Eritrea. And then verse 7 of chapter, third chapter of the book of Habakkuk continues on to say that, and the curtains of the land of Midian. So Midian, kind of like, if ones recall, like, when Jethro kind of interceded on behalf of Moses and set up judges, well, that's basically what it's trying to, we accept it as what it's trying to declare here, the word at least. The land of the judges, of the rulers, of them that were responsible to provide collective security for smaller states, indefensive and the innocent small city states, you know, and so did tremble. They were disturbed. They were disrupted, and so basically we just brought that forth, and now. What we were kind of going to reference would be the book of St. Matthew, chapter 12, verse 38, 39, and how it, you know, it makes mention of the wicked, adulterous generation that seek it after signs. No sign shall be given to them but the sign of Jonas the prophet. As he was in the belly of the whale 3 days, 3 nights, so will the Son of Man be in the heart of the earth 3 days, 3 nights. And then the men of Nineveh shall rise up in judgment, and then the queen of the south shall rise up in judgment. Now, we would like to make mention, you know, like, we accept Ethiopia to be the heart of the earth, and so we know that from the visitation of Queen Maket of Ethiopia to Jerusalem to visit Solomon, and her bringing back of the seed of David, that took place roughly around 1000 BC, and if we add 3000 years, being established by scripture that 1000 years is like the day of the Lord, and so, you know, that's kind of like 3 days. It would kind of lead us up to the year 2000, but you know, we're not even trying to get all that precise. We know it that only the Almighty have full and complete knowledge, and He knoweth the exact dates. I mean, we can't even be all that sure that the dates that are given to us are just exact, you know. And so, like, roughly, we're just gonna indicate the birth of Lich Tefri, that man child, in Ethiopia, 1892. You know, it's give or take a few years. It's the completion of 3 days, 3 nights in the heart of the earth, you know, carefully surrounded by the rocky and mountainous regions, the highlands of Ethiopia, you know, that natural barrier defending that sanctuary, as one of the Psalms reads, Judah was a sanctuary, that protection, that place designated to preserve the truth, to bear witness in these last days to truth, and be a testimony, a living witness, living testimony of what truth is. And so that's pretty much like what we wanted to make mention concerning the sign. And then we have the birth of Lich Tefri, and we have, you know, the book of Jonas, how he's to speak before the men of Nineveh. Now we have Geneva, Switzerland in these modern days. We have the affliction of Ethiopia, which would be as accurately stated here. I saw the tents of Cushan in affliction, and the curtains of the land of Midian did tremble. And so there's so much that we could do with this. We could go as far as let's establish the shame of Adam. Now, it is extremely significant that Moses married an Ethiopian, because if we were to go to the book of Exodus, chapter 4, somewhere around chapter 20, maybe. Okay, let us look for that really as quickly as possible. Exodus chapter 4 and verse 20. Okay, 24, and it came to pass by the way in the inn that the Lord met him and sought to kill him. So the Lord was going to kill Moses. Then Zipporah took a sharp stone and cut off the foreskin of her son and cast it at his feet and said, "Surely a bloody husband art thou to me." So he let him go. Then he said, "A bloody husband thou art because of the circumcision." Now this is talking about Moses and his son Gershon, which he named his son with that he had with Zipporah the Ethiopian. He named him Gershon because Moses was a stranger in a strange land. And so basically what we're trying to get to is that Zipporah saves the life of Moses because she quickly realized what was taking place, and she circumcised her son. So this establishes the fact that Moses was not yet learnt in the way of the Hebrew life, and Zipporah was, you know, because based on scripture, Yahweh Elohim had not yet revealed the tablets to Moses, or the commandments and the law, but Zipporah knew exactly what to do. And so this basically establishes how significant and how important it was that Moses marry an Ethiopian woman. So giving Zipporah like more than just credibility, but actuality and truth for what it is, and not for what one wish it to be or pretend it to be or would like it to be. Now we mention this because the circumcision, Moses had slayed an Egyptian. Therefore, he was a murderer. He was a bloody husband to Zipporah, and it was necessary for Zipporah to cut that off from her son, so that his son would be in Yeshua's peace, in Jesus's, Christos's peace, you know, cut off from the forefathers' mistakes and errors and sins, and cut off from whatever his father did, and cut off from his own sins, and that rebirth. At least that's what we accept the circumcision to be a sign of, cutting ourselves off from our past and becoming new in Jesus Christos. Even it is said, and we think it's referencing the book of Romans, New Testament, how the sign of circumcision would be a sign to the Hebrew people. So obviously Zipporah, a Hebrew S. And now Moses, a bloody husband to Zipporah because of the circumcision. Now, if we go forward onto Adam, he too was red and a bloody husband, we could say. Why? Because we are going to go forward and making mention that Adam was the first assassin or the first murderer. It's oftentimes been revealed that it's Cain, but we dare to make mention and say that it was Adam because Adam broke covenant. Adam, he murdered and violated the confidence and the faith in Jah Rastafari, the Almighty Creator. He killed that contract agreement. He killed that relationship in not keeping the commandments of the Almighty. And he was red in the sense that he was ashamed of the word, and he did not defend the word. He did not stand for that which was right. He did not defend the cause of the Almighty. He kept silent like a lamb led to the slaughter, while Eve was doing all the talking, you know, eventually eating the fruit. And then not only that, but not only did Adam not say anything, he stood there silent, ashamed of the word of truth, but then he took of the fruit as well. Now, you know, so much in that, but basically, Adam was ashamed, therefore losing his light body. He lost the word. In the beginning was the word was with God, the word was God, and the word was the light of man, right? And so basically that light body that was lost was Jesus Christus, was the word of truth, that which is to be, was, and will always be, and nothing else can be but that, you know, the will of the Almighty. So basically we kind of we make mention of that because in these latter days it was the same situation before the League of Nations. No one dared to speak out for the just, defend the cause of the righteous, and stand up for what is true and right, and you know, stand before the commandments of the Almighty and defend them, you know. So and in the case of Geneva, Switzerland, it was that covenant of collective security that these more powerful states would defend the defenseless smaller countries. And so that covenant was made void. The leaders of the world did not have what it took to give meaning and content to the words that they had written down on paper, you know, basically covenant violated. And same situation, now we are here again, says His Majesty, same bunch of hypocrites, same people that didn't have the balls to do what was right then, you know. Perhaps this is the last chance for I and I, you know. It's no longer what country is going to beat the other country, or what, how many world wars. Basically, it comes down to the survival of humanity or the extinction of all man. And basically, we just make known that the main focus of this reasoning, and this is Wendell Alonzo on behalf of the Lion of the Tribe of Judah Society, we bring forth this reasoning, and the main message is that we need to stand up and speak and defend the cause, and not be as Adam, you know, red and ashamed and blushing, and even transgressing the commandments of I and I, God and Father, in Jesus Christus, in grace, by the will of the Almighty, Kedemawi Haile Selassie, King of Kings of Ethiopia. You know, this is it's done already, you know. And so, like, care not for how we are to go about it. It is only that we seek it and love it, the Almighty, with all our heart's desire, and he'll be there for us, you know. Just have faith in him and not have faith in anything else, you know. Eve and Adam obviously put their trust in someone else, but blessed is the man that that trusted in the Lord, in Getachin Jesus Christos, and Geta Jesus Christos, Yeshua HaMashiach, you know, in the power of the Trinity, completing that which we not necessarily have to overstand, but just know that it's true and accept it for what it is, you know, the Son, the Father, and the Holy Spirit. We just basically, you know, long story short, we must put our trust in him, and as his majesty says, I assure you, he will not let you down, you know. And so it comes down to putting our trust in him and seeking him with all our hearts. You know, it's not about who knows more scriptures. It's not about it. Honestly, it comes down to, do you really want it? And if you do, the Almighty Creator, knowing the hearts of all men, you know, like, he'll judge accordingly, depending on each individual case, you know. So it's not about how many works we do, but it is about how much we put into it and how much love. Basically, we need love towards the Most High God, Jaras, the Far Eye. We need to desire him, we need to seek him, and we could do that through studying and basically trusting in him that all will be well. And thus it's that consuming that burning bush, that consuming fire that does not consume itself, you know. We'll be at peace, and we'll have assurance that the day on the morrow shall bring forth good, and that the righteous and the just shall prevail inevitably, you know. Even if we go through some trials and tribulations, like Jonah, perplexed and fainting but not forsaken, you know in your hearts that the Almighty, he knoweth why he does things. Don't question him. Don't be victims of that stupid ologies of, if God was good, he wouldn't do this to me, and I deserve that or this. You know, just take what's coming and know that it's for a good reason. The Almighty knoweth why. And so, you know, we must have faith in those times of tribulation, times of trials, of temptation, and in knowing that we've already overcome in Jesus Christos, you know. And whatever we go through, know that Jesus Christos has been through worse, and he gave his life for I and I to be able to prevail and conquer, as he did, as our Father did, you know, through faith. You know, that Lutheran Christmas special interview, if I would have not had faith in the Almighty, you know, then the rest of the countries would have lost interest in Ethiopia, and by thus, like, the rest of my country, Ethiopia, my people, would have lost faith, and all would have been lost, basically. But since His Majesty was able to keep His faith in the Almighty, and in that, the just and the righteous, although they may, with patience, although they may suffer for a while, inevitably they will prevail, and, you know, the just cause shall be established. So basically, it's what we're trying to present here, that we keep our faith and trust it in him, in and through Jesus Christos, and none other, basically. And to speak out, to speak truth, to not be ashamed. We are to love him and to be proud of it, and display it willfully and happily and joyfully. You know, no shame in loving His Majesty. And thus, we recommend that one take studying seriously, even if it's a verse, even if it's a paragraph, who cares? Just desire to get closer to the Word, to comprehend the Word, to be familiarized with the Word, you know, and the Word of truth, thus learning truth and receiving truth. Don't worry of how that's going to happen. The Almighty will do what he does best, and you'll play your role in responsibility, and we all will make up for that which the other lacks, because in the body of Christ, there's none lacking, you know. And so basically, we say study and become knowledgeable in the Word of truth, eventually living truth, but, you know, in grace, you know, it takes time, and we shall perfect our bodies. But nonetheless, in knowing scripture, You get that peace of mind, that tranquility, and that assurance that all things will be well. Because when you know scripture, then you know that everything that has ever been and is and will always be is that, but only the will of the Almighty. And so that gives you comfort for today, for yesterday, and for tomorrow, in knowing that just causes will ultimately prevail, always, you know. And so we give thanks to all. And this reasoning was, going back and forth, kind of not organized in a way, but it makes no difference. I mean, the points are clear. We must trust him. We must seek and desire, therefore loving him with all our hearts, might, soul, everything. And he will not, let us down. So basically, it's what we have to say. Shalom, Rastafari.